Well, this is a devastating assessment of Australia's environment.
I'm actually still shocked by it and quite depressed.
Our beaches, our forests, our wildlife, our environment is in crisis.
The official State of the Environment report, prepared for the federal government every 5 years, released at last.
This report was delivered to the government last year. The previous minister chose to keep it hidden, locked away until after the federal election. And when you read it, you'll know why.
And this is what's at stake.
Crystal blue sky, clearer than anywhere else in the world. The perfect ring of beaches that meet the sea, or the corrugated red ridges of Central Australia. Every time, that same feeling, that feeling of home stirring inside us. That's our natural heritage. That's what we're committed to protecting.
2,556 pages, a story of devastation. The report finding all five areas of Australia's environment are deteriorating.
We have a level of climate impact not seen in previous reports, particularly from extreme events like bushfires, floods, droughts, storms that have added a layer of extra pressure on already stressed ecosystems.
The report makes for grim reading. Australia has lost more mammal species than any other continent. 202 animal and plant species have been added to the threatened list since 2016. There are now more non-native plant species in Australia than native ones, and 18 of our ecosystems are showing signs of collapse or near collapse.
7.7 million hectares of land has been cleared since the national law has been put in place that is meant to protect the habitat of animals. Our laws are failing us.
But it's not too late to turn it around. Pressure now mounting on the new government to take more urgent action.
Band-aid solutions are not going to work here. We need to drastically strengthen our environment laws, stop the destruction of habitat, and stop pollution.
It really is going to take all levels of government, all of our industries, all of our people joining forces together if we are to reverse the declines that we're seeing across Australia.
And the Environment Minister, Tanya Plibersek, joins us now. Minister, you assumed the role as Environment Minister 6 weeks ago. Presumably this was on your desk when you got there. What was your first thought when you read it?
Well, it was really shocking, Waleed. I mean, as the report said, it's well over 2,000 pages. The executive summary's about 280 pages. And on every page, there are stories that talk about how our environment is in a terrible state and actually getting worse. So it's bad and deteriorating. And if we keep doing what we've been doing, if we head in the same direction, unless we change our laws, change our systems, we're going to keep seeing this environmental destruction continue. It's a very strong call for action on climate change and action on our environmental laws and institutions.
Well, you've set a goal of protecting 30% of the land by 2030. Currently, I think it's 19.75% of land mass is protected in the National Reserve System. How did you come up with the 30% figure?
Yeah. Overall, it's a bit over a quarter of our land that's protected. And the 30% of land and 30% of oceans protected by 2030 is an international target that we are signing Australia up to. We globally believe that we can protect 30% of land and 30% of oceans by 2030. This is a really important thing for Australia to support at home and internationally, because we know, for example, that if we protect part of our ocean, that's where the fish breed, that's where the animals recover. It's not just good for the environment, it's also good, for example, for the fishing industry to have those protected areas. When we're talking about protecting 30% of our land, that's absolutely critical for giving threatened species the habitat they need to survive. As your report mentioned, we've seen massive mammal extinction in Australia, the worst in the world, really. And unless we have habitat for those creatures, they're going to keep being threatened or becoming extinct. And that's a terrible legacy to leave for future generations.
Hi, Tanya, it's Julie here. What kind of land...
Hi,
Tanya. What kind of land, what type of land will be included in the additional protections?
Well, we're looking at World Heritage areas, national parks, Indigenous protected areas. There's a range of different kind of ownership structures, I guess. But the important thing is to have a broad cross-section of land types or ecological communities. So, of course, we need rainforest and we need desert. We need cool climate and hot climate. And we need to have a kind of representative cross-section of our Australian landscapes, because we don't want to see any of our landscapes lost, any type of landscape lost.
I'm interested in the ocean aspect of it. You mentioned 30% of ocean being protected. That's the international target. The reporting around this says, though, that currently we protect 36%. So that sounds like actually we're setting a target that's lower than what we're currently doing. Why would we go backwards? Yeah.
No, we wouldn't go backwards. We're saying 30 by 30 is a minimum, and we are doing well in terms of protecting area of our ocean. There's still more that we can do. We, of course, have been... Australia has been campaigning for some time to see the East Antarctic ocean area included in the protected areas, because we know how important those Antarctic oceans are. For the whole ecological system of Antarctica, from krill to giant whales, we need to make sure that our oceans are protected from overfishing. When Labor was last in government, we actually added really substantially to our marine national parks. Unfortunately, when the Liberal government then came in, they took a larger area out of that high conservation the high conservation category than any other amount of... I'm trying to explain this. It's the largest amount of conservation area ever removed from protection in Australia. They cut the... Well, I mean, you'd have to ask them. Yeah, you'd have to ask them, yeah.
Tanya, is the government considering embracing more Indigenous land use practices in the wake of this report? It seems like a golden opportunity.
It's a great question, Julie. I mean, we've got 65,000 years of land management practice to learn from. First Nations Australians have managed this country and our oceans and waterways really effectively, and thousands of generations have passed down that knowledge. And, of course, any sensible modern conservation program should take on that knowledge. And a couple of things we're doing. We're doubling the number of Indigenous rangers that do such a great job in our national parks. There'll be 3,800 by the end of the decade, and they'll make a huge contribution to those land management practices and water management practices that you're talking about. We're also very substantially increasing funding for Indigenous protected areas. It's a really great way of adding to that area of protection that we're talking about. So we have to add to the area of Australia that we're protecting, but we also need to make sure that we're effectively managing those areas that we protect. We have national parks at the moment where we've got feral animal problems, where we've got invasive weed species taking hold. So it's both. We need to add to the land, and we need to better manage that land.
It's a massive space to watch, Tanya. There's the looming fight on emissions reduction targets in Parliament. There's a lot to go through. You've got a huge portfolio. We'll no doubt speak to you again about it. In the meantime, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.